and for attending this wonderful Paracon, and for visiting this fabulous town of Eureka. I can see that you are all awesome people. Go to the next one. People. Talking about people happens to be the theme of my lecture. I work with many people on different levels. As a psychic, people are offered counsel. As an author, people are written about. As a TV host, people are interviewed. And as a remote viewer, people that are lost in cold cases are found. And last but not least, as a paranormal investigator with the ability to see the dead, yay, communications are extended to those people who have crossed over. Oh yeah. There are wonderful people who now live and work in Eureka, as were the people who in the past era did the same. So for this paranormal event in town, how about we recognize those people who have come and gone before us? Perhaps they remained here in Eureka, or perhaps they came back for a visit or plan on an extended stay. Perhaps you will have communications with them during this Paracon. People such as John Craigobot, who was a delegate to the U.S. House of Representatives from Nevada Territory from December 1861 to March 1863. John was born on February 22, 1819, and he died here in Eureka on February 22, 1872, at age 53. Upon his retirement, his career being that of a lawyer and judge too, he engaged in the mining business until his death. Maybe he is still delegating, judging, and mining here. Good old Mormon Joe might still be here at the Opera House. At one time, the Eureka Opera House, I don't know if it still does or not, but it contained several businesses below the stage on the ground floor. Joseph Barker, known as Mormon Joe, was a tailor in the building and the only documented mortality in the Opera House that is told. On October 31st, 1896, Joe had taken burning embers from the bonfire at the courthouse and took them to his shop for warmth. Well, Barker fell asleep and the fire got away from him and he suffocated in the smoke. The opera house was badly damaged, with the entire front of the building and the hall burnt and blackened by the fire. Well, it's been remodeled beautifully. Perhaps Mormon Joe is still tailoring in his shop. As a side note, I wonder if opera singer Emma Nevada, born in 1880, might have returned back to sing in the opera house after her death in October 1952 as well. Theodore Buffy built Buffy Station, which is a stopping place for the miners and teamsters on their way to Eureka, Mineral Hill, and the old town of Union. The station was a favorite spot for miners who became leaded and believed a sure cure was promised by a few wigs at Buffy's, bathing in water from the mineral hot springs and drinking sour milk to eliminate the lead in their systems. Perhaps Theodore is still running his house for the miners. Okay. Daniel Morrison was born in 1857 in Scotland. Immigrating to America, and then to Eureka, Daniel was co-founder of the Windfall Mine in this area. He was a wealthy man from his mining ventures at one time, but lost all his money due to bad loans. He owned the Brown Hotel in Eureka, which is now the Jackson House. As a piece of trivia, it was noted in the 1930 census that he didn't own a radio. Perhaps he owns one now, and maybe you could hear it playing at the Jackson House. On January 10, 1848, Reinhold Sandler was born in Poland. He immigrated to America, first moving to Virginia City, and later to Eureka in the mid-1870s. Reinhold worked as a miner, a miller, a merchant, and was elected treasurer of Eureka County in 1880. As a merchant, Sandler built a tunnel from the basement of his home to his store across the street so he wouldn't have to brave the Nevada elements to get to work. Mr. Sandler eventually became the governor of Nevada from 1896 to 1903. And after finishing his term, he returned here to Eureka to his establishments. Now, Sandler happens to be buried in Moon Mountain Cemetery in Carson City, but I believe he came back to Eureka upon his demise at age 58, 1906. And then he still walks his tunnels back and forth from his house to his business. That's cool. All right. Lucinda Parker Duncan. Hundreds of people traveling by wagon train to their new home and promising dreams on the other side of the Sierra Nevada died on the California Trail. The journey was hard on the body and soul, and historians say that the route averaged a grave every 500 feet. Lucinda was born in 1793 and died of a heart attack August 15, 1863 on her journey west. She was a matriarch of a wagon train composed mostly of her family members. And by necessity, she was buried next to the trail and her family continued on west. 5 years after her death, workers of the Central Pacific Railroad discovered her crude grave where the tracks were scheduled to be laid. They dug her up and moved her to a hill just south of where she was. Now, over the years, her grave was called the Maiden's Grave, even after her age was discovered, approximately 70 years old. Perhaps Lucinda is waiting in a grave for her family to come back for her. Dr. Mary Hill Fullstone was born on August 3rd, 1892 in Eureka. She enrolled in medical school and graduated from there in 1918, having served her residency period at San Francisco's County Hospital and Children's Hospital. The flu epidemic hit hard that same year. It affected 500 million people across the world, including remote Pacific Islands and the Arctic. In those days, there was little any doctor could do to help a person stricken with the flu, and Mary did her best. After a very long career administering medical aid to several northern Nevada towns, she died in December of 1987, 4 months past her 95th birthday. Now, I believe Mary is healing the sick here in Eureka, and if so, let's hope there's no flu virus. Could William Russell still be at the old Eureka Garage? On the property where the old Eureka Garage stood was a livery stable built and operated by the Granville family in 1915. The Granville sold the stable to William H. Russell and his wife. William was a contractor, and at the time of the purchase, the automobile age was just starting. So William tore down the livery stable and built a white garage. It was one of Eureka's first service stations. And, as a piece of trivia, by 1930, it boasted having a radio. William died suddenly of a heart attack at age 59 in 1935, and his wife, Annie, continued to run the garage. Undoubtedly, I think William's still there fixing cars at his garage. Tracy Knight was born in Eureka in 1891. Tracy weighed 90 pounds and stood 4 feet, 10 and 1/2 inches tall. She was very proud of her horsemanship and had an uncanny ability with snakes. She was not afraid of snakes. One time while riding the range, she found a rattler and killed it. So she picked the rattler up, put it in her pocket, got back on her horse and rode home. Now at her home, there was a man inside painting the house. When Tracy pulled the snake out of her pocket to show her family, the snake started to curl around her wrist. And she quickly shook it off. And the painter was so scared he threw a pillow at Tracy and caused her nose to bleed. Now one time, during the haying season, the work hands were sleeping in tents. Tracy found a nest of water snakes and she tied them in a bunch and then tied them to the pole, the tent pole, so when the men would leave their tent, they would naturally grab onto the pole. Well, they weren't amused. They threatened to throw her in the pond and not come in here until she had gone down three times and Tracy didn't know how to swim. Now, passing away in September 1987, maybe Tracy is still the snake whisperer around these parts. William John Ferguson was born in Eureka on October 31st, 1920. He was appointed judge of the United States Courts of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit by President Jimmy Carter. Ferguson was in office from November of 1979 to June 2008 upon his demise. Now, as a piece of trivia, one noted case of Ferguson's ruling in the Sony Corporation of America versus Universal City Studios Incorporated in 1979, which ushered in the era of home video recording by allowing Sony to market the Betamax. Perhaps upon his death, he came back to see how his birth town was doing and how advanced video recording had become. Oh, you're ahead of me there. Let's not forget those of the spiritual standing. In 1914, the Right Reverend George Coolidge Hunting, who had been seasoned to the rigors of Nevada by years of missionary work here and in Utah, came to Eureka. Hunting recognized that the churches built in the mining towns such as Eureka and Austin and Virginia City were virtually empty of worshipers. Soon, gathering parishioners, he received high praise as a vigorous missionary and was a tough-minded administrator who dealt severely with those disloyal and recalcitrant clergy among the clerical drifters so often found in the Western mission field. But Nevada elements soon took over. In spite of his otherwise robust health, Hunting succumbed to pneumonia and died within days in 1924. Now perhaps he is still administering spiritual counsel at the St. James Episcopal Church at 101 South Spring and Gold Streets here in Eureka. The Eureka Consolidated Mine on Ruby Hill took many lives. Perhaps these men in spirit form are still working the earth, such as John Kelly, who was crushed by falling rock, dying on January 17, 1874, or Edward Baudry, who was killed in an accident at the mine on February 22, 1874, or James Hoskey, who died June 20, 1874, when he was crushed in the lava shaft, or when at 4 o'clock in the morning on June 31st, 1875, Patrick Gates, Edward Duffy, Timothy Leahy, and Henry Beckstead were killed in a cave-in. On January 5th, 1886, William Peters, while running a carload of waste rock from the workings, ran it into the wall of a shaft, and both man and car fell to the bottom, a distance of over 500 feet. And poor John Ryan, he died on April 14, 1874, falling down a shaft when he was trying to take coffee to the miners. Now, if the mines didn't kill you, the miners killed other miners. Like a man named Mr. Green that was fatally stabbed at Ruby Hill by Jay Rowlett on September 18, 1876. Both men were miners, and the weapon used to kill Mr. Green was a miner's candlestick. Or when, on June 12, 1880, Denny Ryan Miner was shot and killed by Abe Randolph Miner on Ruby Hill. Or when, on December 28, 1880, Charles Lynn died from the stabs he received at the mine on December 23rd. Senseless killings took out many of Eureka's populace, such as John Brannan, whose career was making lots of money fighting in saloons. He was killed by a citizen's gunshot on June 16, 1874. Mr. McKinney was shot by Chris Howard in June 1874 in an argument over the love of a Native American maid. H.C. Fenstermacher was shot and killed November 23rd, 1874, for starting a fight in the bar. Joseph Dutch Joe Schramm, gambler, was shot and killed by Dan Sullivan, fellow gambler, on April 7, 1876. On July 31st, 1877, Elisha Gibbs fatally shot his wife, and no one knows why. In September of 1877, a bold attempt to rob a stage outside of Eureka led to the death of one of the highwaymen, the infamous Jack Davis. And also in September of 1877, Kate Miller, known as Bulldog Kate, was stabbed by Mary Irwin in a saloon fight. And also, Mr. C.B. Green was murdered in 1873 by a stranger that was stealing his horses. And as a piece of trivia, his death was noted in the local newspaper that Mr. Green had a small chin but a full beard. I guess this characteristic was important when reporting an obituary of that time. Now, strange accidents also led to the demise of citizens, like this poor fellow, Mr. Peterson, who suddenly died on a dance floor at Pete Esterly's dance house on October 28, 1873. He was 40 years old at his age. Or like Joseph Fortsteiner, who died on May 11, 1876, as a result of being gored by two oxen 2 weeks earlier. And like Joseph Dashcombe in August of 1876 and James Hughes in 1885, both dying of accidentally shooting themselves after heavily drinking. Infant death and was common, as well as illness taking the lives of Eureka's denizens, such as with baby Mary Stella Britton, who died in September 1873, as did the infant son of Captain W.L. Kramer in November of 1873. Tuberculosis, and Timothy Carter died May 10, 1876 from pneumonia. Now, Mother Nature can quickly remove life, as it did on July 24, 1874. In 1/2 hour, starting at 3 p.m., a deluge of rain set in with uninterrupted violence that led to terrible disaster. Down two canyons came a thundering ocean, which carried everything floatable before it, tearing up most of Eureka. Many people who took shelter in their premises when the rains began were hemmed in with no sign of escape as soon the rapid waters moved buildings from their foundations and carry them downstream. Those who chanced to be on the more raised sections of town were trying desperately to save the residents, but were also carried away with the floodwaters, never seen alive again. The flood lasted just 30 minutes, did its work well in that time. The scene was one of dissolution, despair, and bitter mourning. Numerous residents lost their entire property, with the devastation adding up to $100,000. Now, in 2017, the equivalent of that cost is $20,469,636.24. Among those that died in the flood were Roger Romanet, who was a brilliant young reporter, newspaper reporter, who was carried downstream with the printing office and drowned. Mrs. Charles Boyd, who drowned in her home as it was carried away by the waters, was just 6 weeks married. Her bridal dress became her burial shroud. And Mr. James Calvin drowned as he was trying to save a woman and her child, the woman being one of two ladies that died in the flood waters. Now, Mother Nature, the Mayans, the miners, and the killings weren't sufficient in relieving Eureka of its residents, and suicide did the job, such as with Mr. Charles L. Strong, the former manager of the Geddes Mill, who committed suicide on February 10, 1883. Strong was obsessed with the idea that he had been victimized with the purchase of the Belmont Mine near Tonopah, in which he had invested his all. But as the Geddes Mill was new, only running 6 days upon his death, it needed time to get into good shape. Still, Charlie decided it was too much for him to go on. Those who knew Mr. Strong readily believed that he would do himself in rather than meet with failure in any important undertaking. Charles was obviously hasty in his conclusions. Let's hope Mr. Strong found his way back to the mine, seeing it became a successful endeavor. And one last account. What about animals? Perhaps the spirits of animals are seen around Eureka environments. Now, according to Reno's Nevada State Journal edition on November 30th, 1872, the dreaded epizootic horse disease had arrived in Eureka and struck down numerous horses in this vicinity. In the early 1880s, there were 3 dogs to every human being in Ruby Hill. Who fed them? The Nevada Appeal newspaper on December 27, 1886, printed this article about Eureka. It has become the fashion for young ladies to go out driving and hunting. One young lass on this day fired from her buggy, killing 7 rabbits with a rifle. She also shot the head off a chicken at 30 yards. It could very well be the spirits of these animals from an era are still walking the streets of Eureka, along with the people mentioned. As you can see, there were fascinating people in Eureka and animals living out their different roles in a bygone era. I believe, during the many investigations scheduled for this Paracon, one, two, or more of these spoken about in this lecture will be discovered by you. And if so, I hope your communications with them will be as interesting as their personal histories are. Perhaps those in spirit will find you as intriguing as well. Thank you all very much. Give yourself a big round of applause.